Tesla Model 3 tuned by the Unplugged Performance has crashed at the Pikes Peak during a test run. The crash was captured on multiple cameras. I will show you the pictures and the video from the crash, but it looks like the car will still compete in the main event on Sunday. InsideEVs contributor Tom Moloughney will be here to talk about what happened and tell us about his own experience behind the wheel of the Tesla Model 3 competitor in China, Xpeng P7. Byton may be coming back from the dead. Lucid Motors shocks us again with the size of its battery that will produce 517 miles of EPA rated range. Bollinger unveils a new all-electric delivery van, and their CEO Robert Bollinger will be here to explain. Jaguar will produce a cheaper version of the I-Pace. We have a better idea of what the next version of the Chevy Bolt will look like. And Tesla, along with the FBI, prevents a massive hacker attack from, where else, my home country of Russia. Oh, Боже, еще этого не хватало. Anyway, all of this is coming up next. Welcome to E4 Electric, your number one source of weekly electric car scoop. If this is your first time here, all you have to do is click on the subscribe button and the bell notification icon so you don't miss anything moving forward. Tesla Model 3, powered by the Unplugged Performance, has crashed during its practice round at the Pikes Peak, but a quick action from their team, and by the way, nobody got hurt, with collaboration with Tesla, looks like it's going to put this car back on the racetrack at the main event on Sunday when this video airs. The pictures shot by our friend at Tesla Photographer and the footage from the inside of the car shot by the Unplugged Performance show that the Model 3 went into a dipped part of the track a bit too fast and lost control. It did go airborne and barely missed end section of that wall, but just like I said, the driver is fine and ready to go on Sunday. For more, we turn to the InsideEVs contributor, Tom Moloughney. All right, Tom, so we've seen this big crash only a few days ago, but now the word on the street is that this car may be back racing pretty much by the time this airs. How is this possible?
Yeah, so, you know, there's three teams that brought Model 3s to Pikes Peak, and two of them are out during the trial run periods. You know, the one you're talking about is the Unplugged Performance team. They had a really bad crash. And originally they thought that they bent the frame, compromised the battery, which would mean they would be done. But after they got the car back to the garage, they found out that wasn't the case. The battery, the frame was fine. So they actually called Tesla and bought another Model 3 Performance and had it shipped like same day. It must have been somewhere close by to their garage. And they're now stripping all the parts that broke out of their car, out of the new car, and putting them in their car so they can be back on Sunday, which is only 2 days after the crash, and enter the race.
Now, you mentioned that there are three Teslas and all Model 3 in that race, which kind of surprises me because, you know, Tesla Model S, the Raven Edition, is still the fastest and best performing on a racetrack. How come no one's bringing that?
Well, you know, the Model S Raven is the fastest in a straight line. I don't know if it's the fastest on a track with turns. And Pikes Peak is all about turns as you wind up the mountain. So, you know, I actually think the Model 3 would be a better vehicle for that kind of race, because it handles better. But again, you know, I'm not a racing expert, but there has to be a reason, as you said, why all three teams that entered brought Model 3s and not Model S's. I'm guessing it's because of the handling.
All right. Now, speaking of getting behind the wheel at a closed course track, you became the very first journalist in America to drive the brand new Xpeng P7, which is, I think, a very exciting sedan. I've been featuring it on this channel on my social media. Tell us a little bit about that. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, so the Xpeng P7 is Xpeng's second vehicle. They already originally came out with the G3, which is a compact SUV, but now they have this super long range sports sedan, kind of slots in between the Model 3 and the Model S size-wise, but it's a direct competitor to the Model 3 because its pricing is actually a little bit less than the Model 3s. 430 horsepower, dual motor, all-wheel drive. The thing, you know, was absolutely amazing. I really enjoyed my time with it. The suspension is set up a little bit softer than the Model 3. The Chinese market looks a little bit more about comfort than they do sport and handling. So the Model 3, in my opinion, would beat it pretty handily on a track. But as far as a daily driver that combines luxury, comfort, and also performance, the P7 is an excellent choice. And I think XPeng is going to do really well with this vehicle.
Check out Tom's full report about his test drive of the XPeng P7 on his own YouTube channel. I put a link to it in the description of this video. We'll circle back to more Tesla news later in this video. But for now, let's move on to our next story. Of course, before that, a quick reminder that this video and this channel is sponsored by OptiWatt. Do you know how much electricity your Tesla actually uses out of your monthly electric bill? I bet you do not. OptiWatt will track it, let you know what it is, and save you some money by adjusting your charging times to when it's the cheapest with your time of use plan. It will also tell you how much you're already saving by using electricity over gas. Check it out, it's completely free. Go to getoptiwatt.com or use the link in the description of this video. Let's move on to our next story, which is about Byton. I know most of us already said goodbye to Byton. Yes, I was crying. I fell in love with this brand at their very first unveiling. Unfortunately, a couple of months ago, they've announced that they're pretty much ceasing the operations, and that looked like it was the end of it. However, there are now reports coming out of China that Byton may be coming back. The report suggests that the operations may resume as early as next month under a different name. The company will also try to go public and try to raise about $250,000 from their main investor, FAW Group. It looks like that part of the deal is that the third of the capacity of the Byton factory will be reserved for making electric cars for another FAW Group brand called Hongqi. And this is what a lot of people were afraid of, is that FAW had so much power as an investor that at some point they will use Byton to take over their factory for their own good. The only thing that I didn't see coming, that it was for the brand called Hongqi. The company will only continue to operate in China. The US and European offices will remain closed. Byton's CEO, Daniel Kushner, that you've seen on the show many times, have left the company. Now, let's talk about Lucid once again. Another week, another shocking announcement. After announcing the 517-mile range, the 350-kilowatt top charge rate, the best drag efficiency of 0.21 of any sedan, and then teasing a possible quarter-mile record, Lucid has unveiled that the 517-mile range will be achieved with just 113-kilowatt-hour battery, a much smaller size than previously thought. However, it doesn't appear that Lucid has achieved some sort of a battery technology breakthrough. The battery cells are provided by LG Chem, but according to their CEO, Peter Rollison, this milestone was achieved with something else.
We approach this from a deeply scientific approach, really just using the laws of physics in an imaginative way to create some world-class engineering.
In another few days, Lucid will be sharing the quarter-mile times that they have achieved at the Sonoma Raceway. As you could probably see, I was there. However, unfortunately, I can't tell you what it is just yet, so stay tuned. General Motors has given us a little bit of a sneak peek of what the next generation Bolt is going to look like. It will go in production about a year from now. There will be two versions, the regular Bolt EV and the Bolt utility vehicle, the EUV. EUV is a slightly bigger version, and yes, the seats will be finally updated in both. Here's the rendering from the electric design, which I think is pretty close to what I saw myself back in March when I visited GM's headquarters in Detroit and got to see both models. I'm still not a big fan of the exterior design. However, I just put out a video about the current Chevy Bolt's top 5 unique and useful features that I think a lot of people don't know about. So check it out in my channel's library. Bollinger has unveiled an all-electric delivery van called Delivery. Clever and funny. Bollinger claims that this van will go in production in 2022 and will have a variety of different battery sizes, anywhere from 70 kilowatt hour all the way to 210. We know that Rivian has an order of 100,000 of electric delivery vans from one of their investors, Amazon, and Mercedes-Benz has just received a small order of 1,800 electric vans from Amazon last week. However, Bollinger's first vehicles, B1 and B2 trucks, are not due to enter production for another year, and that poses an obvious question, which I did ask their CEO, Robert Bollinger. All right, Robert, we haven't talked in a while, but you got some news about the delivery van. And right. Of course, the question is, you know, why the van? Why, let's say, not a maybe a smaller version of one of the trucks, maybe a more affordable version? What's going on with the delivery van concept?
Yeah, so basically the reason why we even went down that path is because we had outside companies come and ask us about delivery vans. So a little while ago, we had a press release about our chassis, you know, the electric chassis that's underneath our trucks.
Yeah.
And so that as a separate, you know, platform, you know, we announced how that's our platform underneath our trucks. And so we had a couple of delivery companies come to us and a couple of manufacturers of delivery, you know, stuff come to us and said, hey, can we use that platform for delivery? And then we said, well, actually, no, it's really, that would be the opposite of what you want for delivery, right? Because our trucks have 15-inch ground clearance and all-wheel drive and hydropneumatic suspension and all this stuff you don't need for a delivery van. But what we could do and what we did do is that we designed a platform using our same battery, our same motors, our same inverters, our same everything, all the components inside a new frame and a new layout that's front-wheel drive, really low load floor, and did all the simulation and engineered the whole thing and came up with something that beat the specs of what they gave us of what they want their delivery van to meet.
Jaguar has announced that they will be making a cheaper version of the I-Pace. I personally like I-Pace a lot, however, they haven't been selling too many of these. They've sold only about 5,500 of them globally in the first half of this year. That's 40% less than they've sold in the first half of the previous year, and that wasn't really a number to brag about either. Of course, there's a pandemic going on in 2020. At the same time, the total sales for the I-Pace is about 13% of total Jaguar sales, which is not that bad. The new version will have its price tag drop by about 20% in Europe, so if it ever comes to the United States, the price should drop from just under $70,000 to about mid-50s. I should mention that the Jaguar dealerships here in the United States have already been discounting these cars pretty heavily, to the point where even I'm starting to shop for one myself with all the fall sales coming in about a month or two. Let me know if I should get one, and if so, which color. But the best part is the new, cheaper version of the I-Pace will not see its range decreased at all, so it will stay at the EPA-rated 234 miles. Let's get back to some Tesla news, and there were two news stories that came out last week about two different hacking attempts that were pretty big. One was from a good guy who actually hacked Tesla's mothership, which is the main computer. However, he ended up collaborating with Tesla and they fixed it. But another one was an attempt from Russia, where they tried to recruit one of the Russian-speaking employees at Tesla and take over part of the Tesla's code so they can blackmail them in the future. And it took the FBI and Tesla working together to bring the guy down. Now, all well that ends well. However, this is a big concern because in the future, Tesla and many other manufacturers will be making cars that will be able to drive on their own. So if somebody gets access to their entire fleet, they can really do some damage. Let me give a quick shout out to the fleet that I have access to, which is my Patreon community. Thank you to my newer Patreons, Caleb Frank and Justin Day. Thank you so much for supporting my channel, where I usually go live at least once a week and give you all of the behind the scenes stories. If you want to become a part of my Patreon community, I would really appreciate it. The link is in the description of this video. Looking forward to all of your comments. Other than that, see you guys next time, and remember to stay charged.